Welcome to this mini class in econometrics. I'm Daniel Vullings. I'm a lecturer in econometrics at the Department of Economics, Econometrics and Finance. And today I will give this mini lecture to give you some kind of insight in what econometrics is and for you to see whether this is something you would like to learn more about. I will do this based on the central question, is going to university a good investment? So, of course, you're deciding whether you want to go to university, whether you want to study, and there are many aspects you have to consider, but one is it actually worth my time in terms of expected future income? So that will be the central question, but before we go into that, let's take a look at what is econometrics. So I have looked at the handbook of econometrics for a definition, and their definition, or they write, econometrics is the application of mathematics and statistical methods to the analysis of economic data. And this is, with economic data, we have an interesting thing because, for example, whereas with biology, you can do random experiments. So you can take one group of people and give them some drug, another group of people give them a placebo, and then you can study what the effect is of this drug on these people. In economics, this is often impossible. So one question a government, for example, could have is, what happens if we increase the tax bill to the wealthy? Will they start to work less? Will they leave the country? And the problem is we cannot say to half the wealthy people you have to pay more tax and the other half you will not have to, so that we can do this experiment. This is considered unfair, so we can't do this and have to think of something else. Another example is the question we're discussing now. What is the effect of an additional year of education for your expected income? You cannot say to half the people, okay, you will get more education and other half you will not, to see what this effect is. So we have to come up with something else, and it turns out that because of this we will have to resort to a lot of math and statistics to actually learn something about this or to answer this question in some way. Well, a more specific application of econometrics, so there are several, it's quite broad, but the one that we focus on here is that econometrics tries to find causal effects between economic variables. So we have one variable and that we can influence, a policy parameter, say tax, and then we want to know, does this lead to people leaving the country? We have education. Does an extra year of education lead to higher income? So there's a causal effect between these two variables. And this, again, is not easy to answer. And to do this, we really need a lot of math and statistics. And so if you consider to study this, and this is an important question you have to answer to yourself, are you interested in math and statistics? So if you do not like mathematics or statistics, reconsider this program because it will be a big part of it. For this presentation, I will skip technical details. I won't show you the tip of the iceberg. But recall that in the actual program, you do need these kind of things. So keep that in mind when I proceed, because I will focus on the interesting things and the application of econometrics, but this is not everything you will have to do. So before we go to the actual question of interest, let's look at this figure. So we have on the horizontal axis ice cream, and this is production in the US in 2018, actual data. And this is the number of drownings in the US. So again, this is all actual data. It's monthly data. And we have, this is, for example, is a month where we had like 75 drownings, and we had less than 200 drownings, and ice cream production was 75, whatever the unit is. And what do we see in this figure is that when ice cream production increases, we also see an increased number of drownings. Right, so this is a cluster of points where we have a lot of ice cream production or high ice cream production and a lot of drownings. So what is going on? So the question is do these two really cause each other? Well, if you think about it for a bit, hopefully you come to the conclusion that this is probably not the case. But there's an underlying variable named hot weather. So if it's warm outside, people start to swim. Then to drown, you need to swim. And they start to eat more ice cream. So there's an underlying factor that causes both variables to go up. And this, if we then only look at these two variables, we would draw the wrong conclusion, right? So this is the central problem in the question that we discussed today, namely, what's the return of education? Because here we will see we will have a similar problem. And this actually, so the return of education is a classic problem in econometrics. This is something that for decades has been studied. So, and for some introduction, so you're deciding whether you want to go to university, specifically econometrics, but in general, whether you want to have more education, and then part is, of course, the personal development. You develop as a person, and this is all very important and very nice, and maybe should be the main driver. But another factor is that it leads to an increased income. So if you can also decide to start to work now, and then you have an income now, but you decide to postpone this, and then you should have some return in the future, at least an expectation. So you have to take into account, and the main question you might ask, or our main question is, how much does the expected annual income increase with more education? So if you have more years of schooling, how much does my annual income increase? And to answer this question, we first look into the data. to see, okay, do we have data that makes sense? So this is a histogram of income. So we have income in denoted in thousands of euros. And what do we see? We see, for example, this batch just below 50,000 euro, there are 1,500 observations. And we see that most people fall between 20 and 60,000 approximately, and this represents more or less Dutch income data. So this is data that makes sense. It's always important to study the data beforehand because it could, if you have very strange looking data, something might be wrong. Let's take a look at education. We have years additional to mandatory years in school, so I define it as above 16. And we see very few people have stopped at 16. And then many people have this kind of more applied education. And then the higher education you come, the fewer people actually have it, right? But again, this is data that it makes sense. This is something we would expect. So now we, similar to the ice cream and drowning example, we would like to plot these two against each other. So we would like to plot the data points to see whether this tells us something. So what do we see? So the horizontal axis we have education, vertical axis income, and we see that low levels of education tend to correspond, so the lowest incomes are always for low educations. So for high incomes, there are, for high education, there's no low income, right? It doesn't mean that if you have low education, you have low income. The best way in the Netherlands to make money in the end is to be, or the best, say, to really make a lot of money, you have to become an entrepreneur and have a great idea. And that these are these kind of observations. So you don't necessarily need a lot of schooling, but if you have a great idea, you can make a lot of money from this. So now we have this data and we would like to answer the question, what's the return of education? So we would like to say something from this data about the relation between education and income. So how are we going to do this? Well, we can define a model, so we can put some structure on the data and say, suppose the data follows the structure. And if it follows the structure, what is then the relation between income and education? So we're going to say that income of individual I is equal to alpha plus beta zero times education of individual I. So we have that income increases at a slow beta zero. So we have a linear model. And for every year of education extra, you get beta zero extra yearly income. Of course, this is not a perfect model, so there should be an error term here that I ignore for notation's sake. And then what we have is that this model represents this line. Or it represents a line, and this is the line for a specific parameter. And now the question is, how do we find the slope of this line? Okay, so note that beta zero is something that we cannot know. So we want to come up with some kind of estimate, and so we give it a different name, in this case beta hat zero, to indicate that we estimated the parameter, but we don't actually know it. And we came up with a value of 4.5. The question is now, how did we do this? So intuitively, what you want to do is to take, for example, this point and this point, and say for same for all points, and take the distance from the point to the line. If you take this distance and you add them together, you have some kind of measure for the error you have, right? The problem is that this point will cancel out against this point. So we could have a line that where we have massive errors, but on average, the error is zero. And this is clearly not an interesting result. So we have to come up with some alternative. Now, an alternative is to, for example, consider the absolute value of the error, because then we only have positive errors. But it turns out that analytically, this is a bit troublesome. So and then we come to what's a simple way to get it positive, but still analytically nice results. Well, from high school, you know that if you have quadratic functions, we can easily take a derivative and find the minimum or maximum. Note, in this case, we are interested in the minimum. So why not take the squared error? And this is exactly what we're going to do. So before I go there, the interpretation of the estimated parameter. So the estimate here is that an additional year of education gives 4,500 annual income. So and this, based on this, you might decide, okay, then it's worthwhile to study. And later we will see whether this makes sense. But it's the interpretation of the parameter. Always, as an econometrician, we're really interested in interpretation, right? So we don't only want to find this kind of effects between variables, but also interpret what does this mean for us. Okay, but how did I find this beta hat zero? So as I mentioned, I consider the difference between, so the observed points, so the actual income, and the predicted income, say we take some beta because we don't know the actual beta, we multiply this by the education, and then we take this difference and we take it the square of it. And then we sum it for all observations. So we say we have n observations, and then we square, so we take the sum over all the observations from 1 to n of the squared error, and we call this a criterion of function f. And now we want to find the beta that minimizes this sum of squared errors, right? So because of this quadratic form, it's very convenient to analyze this. And it turns out that if we analyze this, so if we take the derivative, and you can do this at home, so actually try this. There's a lot of sources on the internet that can help you with this, so with a quick Google search. And then it turns out that our estimator is this function of the data. So we have the sum of all the observations of the education squared in the denominator. So this is something we observe. We have the sum of the income multiplied by the education over all the observations. So purely based on the data, we now have an estimate. So we have, according to some criterion, the optimal slope of the line that we're interested in. And then, so we have now determined this line. But now we have to interpret this. So is this actually a sensible estimate? Does it really make sense? Well, up to this point, we used mathematics and statistics, right? So we used this to find this optimal slope. But the question is, and most of it I actually was behind the scene, but assume it was there. But now the question is this result actually something we can work with? Well, economists sometimes claim that the only education is only useful for as a signaling function. So the firms don't care about what you actually learn. They only care about that you are skilled. And skill is very hard to observe. So they just look at education and take this as a kind of proxy for skill. So what you would expect is that more skilled people tend to have higher income because this is what firms actually care about. But they also have more education because it tends to be easier for skilled people to attain a high level of education. So but then we have the same problem as that we had with the ice cream example potentially. So the question is, does our analysis give the true effect of education, or is there a bias due to omitting the skill? And this is why this, now you can think of why this is a classic problem in econometrics. In practice, it's of course almost impossible to measure skill. So this is why firms look at education as a proxy, because they don't have anything better. Luckily for us, I have simulated my data, so I just created data on skill to show what the effect can be. So consider on the horizontal axis skill, the vertical axis education, and we see that low levels of education are always corresponding to low levels of skill, right? Sorry, low levels of skill are always corresponding to low levels of education, and then there appears to be a kind of positive slope. For income, we have a much clearer effect. So we have that there's a very strong correlation between income and skill. So this indicates that we might really have the same problem as with the ice cream example. So we have to we have the same positive correlation, so we have to think, okay, what will the consequence be? So note that there are also other examples of variables that I ignored that might play a role. For example, you can consider experience. If you have more work experience, you tend to get a higher income. If you, years of education, I assumed has a linear effect. But maybe if it's at some point an additional year of education doesn't increase the expected income. If you think about the PhD, so after your master's, you can do 3-4 years of a PhD, which is considered education, but it's also you do a lot of research. And there, for many fields, the private sector doesn't really value it, so the expected income might actually drop a little. So this linear effect is not the most reasonable assumption. And we should, to really get a kind of complete analysis, we should take this into account. For now, I will only focus on adding skill to our analysis. So we shouldn't just fit a line between income and education, but also take these other things into account and think more about the model we have, whether it should be linear or quadratic or. So think for yourself what you think would be a reasonable form. So but now we just extend our model in a simple way, we just add skill. So and then our recalled or naive estimate was 4.5. It turns out that if we include, or if we consider our new model, then our estimate is equal to 2.0 for education. So first we thought that an additional year of education led to 4,500 euros extra annual income. But now it's only 2,000. And we do see that skill plays a very important role. So skill really drives income, and it's also strongly correlated with education. So this biased the results upwards. So clearly, for this analysis, I skipped a lot of technical details. Again, I want to emphasize math and statistics are important for this program. So much of the program considers the how to develop these techniques, how to prove that they work. So make sure that you're interested in this as well, when you consider to study this. So of course, it's nice if you like the application, if you think it's interesting, but consider that there is a lot of technical aspects that you will spend a lot of time on and that you have to like. So to end, we go back to the program. There's a variety of different problems why econometrics is quite hard and why we have to resort to all these kind of techniques. Another example of an application is where we consider the estimation of parameters of stochastic processes. So if you think about, you will get, there's also a mini lecture in operations research, and there they want to get an optimal maintenance scheme for some machines, or they want to have the optimal number of checkouts. But then you need to know, how quickly do these machines deteriorate? How many customers arrive per hour? And to estimate this kind of the deterioration or the arrival of customers, this is an econometric question. So this is another application where econometrics plays an important role. So then to come to the program. So for econometrics, you will get a strong background in mathematics, statistics, and economics. And for the first, we really think whether this is something you're up to that you would actually like to do, because it can be tough. And some students struggle with this. So the program is challenging, but note that it also yields high rewards. So you will get a very broad foundation for whatever career you're going for. You will learn to think critical. You will get a lot of skills that are extremely useful. So there are high rewards, but it's not for everyone. So consider whether you like mathematics, whether you like statistics, and whether you like economics. And then, of course, whether you like this kind of application. And if you do, then I hope to welcome you in the program at some point in the future. But if not, also this is also a choice that you should consider. For now, thank you for listening. This was my presentation.